When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Stand by me. If the sky that we look upon should tumble and fall, or the mountain should crumble to the sea, I won't cry, I won't cry, no, I won't shed a tear, just as long as you stand by me. And darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand now. Stand by me. Stand by me. Stand by me. Whenever you're in trouble, won't you stand by me? Oh, stand by me. Whoa.
All right. Ooh, yeah.
Well, oh, yeah. Here we go, y'all. Sing a little message out to those of y'all who feel like you're struggling.
It's a simple song. Mm. Yeah. La da 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 la da da. Oh yeah. Yesterday, a man stared for me. Said, how can you smile when your world is crumbling down? I said, in my secret. When I wanna cry, I take a look around and I see that I'm getting by.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, everyone, and welcome, welcome, welcome. We welcome you, everyone from far and near. to our first series, of mental health in the Black community, the historical perspective, cultural values, stigma, suicide, and opportunities. My name is Sarah Taylor, a parent of a child impacted by mental health conditions and founder and director of the BIPOC Peak Project. We are Black Indigenous people of color and caregivers who have dedicated our voices to empower each other and educate each other to eliminate disparities. We are Peak, and we want to elevate our voices high as possible. I want to first thank our sponsors and partners who, without them, this would not be possible. Our grant funders who believed in our vision from the beginning. The Wilson Foundation and Junior Dillon, the Greater Rochester Health Foundation, ESL Foundation, Excellus Blue Cross Blue Shield, and our key series sponsors, Hillside Family and Agency and Best Self Behavioral Health, and a host of partners that were featured on the slides. I also want to acknowledge our Parent Ambassador Board, Partners in Community Development Leadership, Lynn Statham, our team, my family, a couple great leaders we're going to hear from today, and a host of sponsors and partners that continue to support our vision. Because our commitment is elevating our voice, we want to stop right now and take a moment to hear a song sung by Ronnie Lewis, the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven. With the harmonies of liberty, let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. That the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. God of our weary years, God of our silence, has brought us thus far on the way. Thou who hast by thy might led into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Oh, lest our feet stray from the places our God where we met be, lest our hearts drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Oh, shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. And again, we thank every parent who has decided they wanted to lift their voice to make a difference. I just want to stop to talk about just briefly who we are. Who we are, what does PEAK stand for? We are what we hope is an emerging, soon-to-be, evidence-based model. PEAK is a program that will serve as an international movement led by Black, Indigenous, people of color, parents and caregivers of children who are receiving services or identified emotional health conditions but not linked to care. We have two core strategies: to build a BIPOC network of parents and caregivers with children impacted, connected or not connected to care. The second is to impact change within the behavioral health providers to foster a system built for our children. So, with that said, we cannot do this alone. While we have system priorities, practices, policies, we have to have legislation. We have to have partners in Albany that have our best interests. We have to have partners in Albany that listen and elevate the parent voice. We are excited that we have a partner right from Rochester, New York, who is also the chair of the Mental Health Committee for New York State Senate. At this time, we will hear from Senator Samra Rook.
Hello, everyone. My name is Senator Samra Rook. I likely represent many of you in the 55th Senate District here in Rochester. I want to thank Sarah Taylor for organizing this wonderful series of events, all designed to shed much needed light on mental health in the Black and Brown community. I want to thank you for being here. As chair of the Senate Committee on Mental Health, I often say that our bills and ideas are only as strong as our relationships with our community. And that's what makes panels like these so, so important. By being here today, listening to this panel, you are showing that the time to prioritize our mental health and well-being is right now. Thanks to advocates like Sarah and many others, folks in Albany are starting to listen up too. In 2021, I was able to pass my legislation that would create a culturally competent mental health hotline, 988. I've also gained bipartisan support for my bill, Daniel's Law, that would reform how we respond to mental health crises in our community, ultimately saving lives of those who are often put in danger when we meet mental health crises with force instead of compassion. I've introduced other legislation that would create a Black Youth Suicide Prevention Task Force and would study maternal mental health to address racial disparities and better support our Black mothers and birthing people. But this isn't about me. This is about you. Please take what you gain from today's panel and make your voices heard. Together, we'll make them listen. Thank you.
We are so grateful to have a partnership with a senator and a leader that understands it and has our best interests. So again, we thank our great senator. I also want to let you know that this is an educational session. This is not meant to be a clinical therapeutic session. We hope to share some resources and information that would advance strategies and opportunities to improve services for Black families and children who are connected, impacted by mental health. At this time, I would like to bring forward someone who is a pillar in this community, in the state, in the nation. We're going to make sure that our tech team has brought the panelists up at this time. And I want to read a little bit about her bio. As we have had leaders in this community that have really been a champion when we talk about culturally and responsive care. culturally responsive care. We have had some leaders that have been around a long time, leaders that have been holding systems accountable, leaders that have been leading strategy, leaders that have been speaking on behalf of our Black and Brown communities, leaders that have said enough is enough, system accountability. At this time, we're going to ask Lenora Reed Rose if she would give remarks. She is the Strategic Leadership Director at CCSI, which we all know as Coordinated Care Incorporated. Lenore?
Okay. I'm so very sorry about that. My technology skills aren't the best. But thank you so very much, Sarah, and good morning. I really want to thank Sarah and the BIPOC Peak organization for not just inviting me, but for creating the space where we can have some really honest and true conversations. The theme of the conference really truly resonates with me as an individual and with the professional work that I have done over the years. One of the things I really want to start out with is, let's begin to look on what happens at the intersection of mental health and one's experience as a member of the Black community. I wanted to ponder that for a little bit. Overall, mental health conditions occur in Black and African American people in America at about the same or sometimes less frequently than with white Americans. However, the historical Black and African American experience in America has and continues to be characterized by trauma and violence more often than for our white counterparts, and impacts emotional and mental health of both our youths and as adults. Historical dehumanization, oppression, violence against Black and African American people has evolved into present day racism. That is structural racism, institutional racism, and individual racism. This cultivates a uniquely mistrustful and less comfortable community experience for us. It's characterized by a myriad of disparities, including inadequate access to and delivery of care in the mental health system. Processing and dealing with all the layers of individual trauma. I just say trauma on top of trauma on top of new trauma. And what happened with COVID? That makes it so much more interesting. That was a whole nother level of trauma on how we were treated and the services that we received. While our experiences that of Black and African-American varies tremendously, we have some shared stuff. There's shared cultural factors that play a role in helping define mental health and supporting well-being, resiliency, and healing. Part of the shared cultural experience, the family connections or values or expression through spirituality or music, reliance on community and religious networks are enriching and can be great and are great sources of strength and support. Racism structures opportunity and assigns value based on how the person looks. This results in conditions that unfairly advantage some and unfairly disadvantage others. It hurts. Racism hurts the health of our Black communities. Racism hurts the health of our nation by preventing some people the opportunity to attain their highest level of health. Racism may be intentional or unintentional. It operates at various levels in our society. It is a driving force of the social determinants of health, like housing, education, and employment. It is truly the biggest barrier to health equity. And for us as Black Black Americans and disadvantaged folks to be getting the kind of help and services that we so deserve. For our Black communities to strive, and I'm so serious about this, we must achieve health equity. To achieve health equity and create healthy communities, we must address injustice caused by racism. We must support actions at all levels to ensure opportunities that lead to equitable outcomes for all. How do we do that? As the conference progresses, you will receive some gems, some true gems. Today we have a panel that is just truly remarkable, and they will leave with us some gems that will help to answer the questions. It is vitally important that public health moves away from old practices and learns how to integrate equity and the social determinants of health into everything that we do. And clearly, many of these practices center around racism. Right now, our Black communities are fighting two pandemics, COVID-19 and racism. Across the country, more jurisdictions are adopting resolutions of declaring racism a public health crisis. We just did so in New York State a few weeks ago, citing growing research linking racism to poor physical and mental health outcomes, as well as data showing Black Americans are many times more likely than whites to be killed by police and also to have outcomes that really truly are not equitable. The racial disparities in COVID-19 deaths has helped expose the structural nature of racism and accelerated the pace of many localities adopting the notion that racism is a public health crisis. I mean, these disparities were around before COVID. Somewhere, somehow, we have been sharing it, we have been stomping at doors, we have been screaming, but COVID brought it to another level where it could not just be ignored, that people needed to be talking about it. There are people who will view these declarations as purely symbolic, and that is true, and in some areas it may be, but symbolism is still very important. For far too long as a country, we have danced around and flat out denied the impact and the experience of racism. In our own backyards, right in Rochester, Common Ground, an organization that we both know, if you don't, then I encourage you to go on the website and look them up. They have a report that has been out since last year, may have been the year before, The Color of Health, the devastating toll of racism on Black lives. And what I want you to think about, this is not data that's some other part of the country. It's not data down in New York City. It's not data down in Milwaukee. It is data that is our experiences and what us as Blacks are experiencing. And some of the highlights that come up from the report are, racism is the primary underlying driver of the deep and persistent health inequities experienced by Black people. Racial bias in housing, education, employment, criminal justice, and other domains condemn Black people in Rochester and the Finger Lakes to sicker and shorter lives. Racism is behind the deplorable high rates of COVID infections and mortality for Black people, behind high rates of heart disease, diabetes, and asthma, behind more Black mothers dying in childbirth, and more Black men dying of violence, sometimes and very often at the hands of those charged with protecting us. This is not national data, folks. This is our data. This is our community's data. For our communities to heal, we must address racism. Our solutions will be lost if we do not do so. One solution I'm going to put forward to you today is the calling out of the fact that racism is in fact a mental health crisis as well. I think very often what we hear is a public health crisis, yes, and mental health is a part of public health, but sometimes we don't recognize it. But I want us to call it out. Racism is a mental health crisis. While many organizations have talked about the impact of continued racist experiences on physical health, fewer explicitly talk about the impact of racism on mental health. I have, however, noticed the conversations have shifted some, and rightfully so, from calling race a factor in mental health and switching that into naming racism as a factor that actually has a significant impact on health outcomes across the communities that have been historically oppressed. While issues of parity may not prevent someone from getting their tooth pulled by a dentist who doesn't know their language or culture, it creates a huge roadblock for providing adequate mental health care, which requires very deep conversation. A colleague of mine, a doctor, who experienced this firsthand many years ago, shared this with me when he was seeking support during a difficult time. These are his words. "I feel in Spanish, Lenora. I need to convey those feelings in Spanish, and I want those I'm speaking with to understand me as such." One either allows racial inequities to persevere as a racist, or confronts racial inequities as an anti-racist. There is no in-between safe space of not racist. The claim of not racist neutrality is a mask for racism. Those are not my words, but I totally agree with them. This is a time and an opportunity where we can really elevate not only our understanding, but also start implementing the change that needs to happen. We can all work together to recognize and address the challenge. But to do so, we must first understand where it comes from and why it is so ingrained in our culture. It is baked, racism is baked into the very systems that are there to protect us. I want to end with this amazing word, hope. There is hope, and we can ensure equity for all. And I know my esteemed colleagues on the panel will give us some clear guidance as to how all of us can work together to ensure equity for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Lenora. Thank you so much for just who you are and the work and the legacy that you have started in this nation, particularly also in this community. I can't thank you enough for being my mentor and my shero and everything else. At this time, we're going to get ready for our panel. We have our experts here ready, and we're going to talk about the mental health in the Black community. We're going to talk about individual responsibility, community responsibility, and system responsibility. And I am a mother that knows firsthand about the systemic rooted issues, the biases, and the inequities. So we're going to talk about it, and we're going to offer some solutions. I am proud to be co-facilitating the panel today, moderating with an esteemed colleague, Junior Dillon, 2021 40 and Under Award recipient, is currently Senior Director for Programs at the Wilson Foundation. He is a leader evaluator with lots of experience in the British criminal justice system, youth development, higher education, or MAPI's funders, alignment council, and currently working on a PhD in human development. And I can tell you, as a parent, last year, Junior took me under his wing as a funder and said, "We believe in your project. We believe in your vision. And we want to get behind you. We want to elevate the parent voice when it comes to funding and services." So I'm happy Junior's going to give a few remarks before we begin the esteemed panel.
Well, pleasure, honor to be here, for sure. And welcome everybody who's here today. You know, I come to this work, this critically important work, really looking at it through multiple lenses. first as a clinician. I'm a licensed mental health counselor, and who has served countless people of color, countless black people, brown people, that the system really has struggled to meet their needs adequately, and really struggled to really examine its own characteristics and how it really participates in re-traumatizing and harming those from marginalized and oppressed community. The system really is set up to treat, but not truly care. And I think that is something that needs to change. Now, as a funder, for me, it's important to remove my ego and concede powers to those who are most afflicted by the mental health system. Because if I'm not working as a servant, then to me, I'm a hindrance in my role. So my job is simply to be a conduit for organizations like Peak, for people like Sarah Taylor or herself, to work and moving the work forward. And I believe that's how people in positions of power and with influence can meaningfully contribute to this mission. So I won't take up any more of your time because we do have an excellent panel coming up, other than to say that I'm honored to be here and it's a pleasure to serve today.
Thank you, Junior. We are going to ask our panelists to get ready to turn on their cameras. We are going to get started. They know their time frame. Each panelist, we will read their brief introduction of their bio one time around. We're going to give them each questions. Junior and I will alternate, and they do know their time frames. Okay? So, panelists, experts, if you can please turn your cameras on. What an esteemed panel. What an esteemed panel that we have today that we are going to hear from. The first panelist that's going to come forth with her question. Dr. Latisse Harrison is Chief Impact Officer at Harvest Opportunities Dynamic, accomplished certified diversity, equity, and inclusion strategist, respected for delivering consistent, creative, database-driven decision-making. She is also a known motivational, influential thought leader who's often called upon to train in the area of racial trauma. She's a licensed counselor, a PhD, and more. So Dr. Latisse, I would give you 3 to 4 minutes if you can share some insight of the historical perspective of racial trauma and what we should know about the realities of the last 20 months and the impact on the Black community, especially children and elderly populations.
Well, first of all, I would like to say and thank you for being here today and for doing this very important work. I want to start off actually with a couple of quick quotes that I want to, James Baldwin said that history is not the past, it is the present. We carry our history with us. We are our history, right? And we know in terms of being overburdened, overextended, stress in the body, a response to carrying more than it can bear. When we are trying to do more than we can, confront more than we can possibly cope with in several lifetimes, we end up feeling that our lives are out of control, that we can only keep a hold on life by managing and controlling it. And that comes from Bell Hooks, who just recently passed away. So I just want to share for a few minutes with you. When we think about race-based trauma, we have to think about this, that American slavery lasted for 339 years. And then we had another 89 years of segregation within this country, right? This country has spent more time upholding a system of bondage than conferring freedom. And remembering that us, as we were called, Blacks being 1/3 of a human, right? So anti-Blackness is actually baked into our history. And systematic racism has its roots in historic racism. And so those are things we have to consider, that our history, when we're talking about race-based trauma, what does that mean? That means the events of danger related to real or perceived experience of racial discrimination. And when we think about historical trauma, we call them soul wounds, right? It is the cumulative psychological wound within our bodies, within our psyche, within our mind that result from historical traumatic experiences such as colonization, genocide, slavery, dislocation, and other related trauma that we deal with every day. And they have these intergenerational effects. So trauma can be transmitted from 7 to 12 generations before us. We carry that trauma, and that trauma can be transmitted to generations ahead of us. But the good news is this, is that we can interrupt this intergenerational trauma in one generation. So just to talk very briefly in terms of some of the impacts, as we know, when we talk about the impacts of COVID, right, we know that COVID has had a profound negative impact on communities of color, and that the pandemic has had a disproportionate impact on BIPOC people, right, in terms of hospitalizations and death, and treatment and lack of access to treatment. We have seen that happen, as well as in terms of older adults who have had a particular burden in terms of isolation, morbidity, right? Really not having access to services in the same way that whites have, right? This population has been cared for and supported by in-home caregivers, families, and staff who have shown amazing resilience in the face of everything that's happened during this pandemic. So we have to realize that steeped within this history of this country is racial trauma. And that continues in all the systems in which we interact with on a daily basis.
Thank you so much for that. Thank you so much for that insight, Dr. Lettice. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to Junior.
Hello again. And so I'll be introducing, the next question is, Dr. Lettice, you're a well sought out expert and trainer and strategist in the realm of diversity and equity inclusion. So if we're going to make transformative changes across the mental health system, what are some of the first steps that we need to take?
Okay. Sorry about that. I turned off my camera. So when we think about, I want us to think about it in various aspects when we think about making changes within systems, right? So starting first from a parental perspective as a parent, right? Part of, there is a Zulu greeting that I often use and refer to, and it's called Sawubona. And it means I see you, right? And within that greeting is actually a contract among each other to be seen and heard and valued. And so from a parent perspective in dealing with these systems that have historically oppressed us, and actually systems in mental health that have actually said that slaves had a mental health disorder because they tried to run away, right? So as a parent, that's really important for each one of us to be able to going back to have our children be seen, be heard, be valued, right? And when we talk from a systemic place and point of view, again, one of the things that in terms of even mind training, it took place within a Eurocentric context, right? And so within that, it did not take into account, even in my training as being a clinician, right? It did not take into the account the culture, the background, the rich history, and the trauma of racism. So from a systemic place, from an organizational perspective, first, in terms of clinicians, we need to do our own work, right? We need to do our own work in terms of understanding the history of oppression. We need to understand the people who are coming before us, the families that are coming before us, what they are dealing with, what is their culture, perspective, and background, and be and have this intercultural competence and being able to see, going back to that piece around Sawabona, to see the people whom we're engaging, and having those individuals. There's the whole concept that comes from disability research about nothing about us without us. And that's a basic principle, to have community involvement, right? And again, that's what we're doing here today, to have community involvement and have our voices heard and be seen and heard and understood.
Thank you, Dr. Lateef. And I did get a little bit ahead of myself there, because we are going to do one question for each round. But I do want to introduce Matthew Knutson, who has leveraged his experience as someone in recovery from substance abuse and the mental health concerns. Matt is interested in the behavioral health field. He's founded and on his gratitude because he was able to succeed despite challenges, and has dedicated his career to ensuring that the same gifts are available to all. Matt joined the Office of Mental Health in 2018, serving as the agency's first diversity and inclusion officer. Welcome, Matt.
Thank you, and it's good to be here. And I'm going to start off by saying a couple things, level setting, personal things first. And you mentioned that I am a person in recovery. And I want to mention a little bit about what that means to me. You know, I was a person that grew up in a rural area, right? And experienced racism, you know, extensively growing up, you know, heard the N-word specifically as a young child, you know, over and over and over, and a whole bunch of microaggressions and, you know, the large things, the small things. And then I was a person that also was in mental health services from an early age. And my life ended up turning into one that was, you know, substance abuse was involved, hospitalization was involved, dropping out of high school was involved. But I say that just to say, today I want us to be coming from a place of power and resilience. You know, I want us to be coming from a place of, you know, hope, because it's very, very important. I'm one tiny, small, tiny little example of the resilience that Black people have, in the ability that we have to be strong, and the ability that we have to change the systems. And I look and I see Lenora and I see Sarah and I see Lateef, I see all these people, Melanie, all these people that I look up to and all these people that I work with. And it really reminds me, you know, of just how special this time is. So the other thing I wanted to say is a tiny little plug on this part. We all do this work, and this work is very hard, right? And we're advocates, and we're clinicians, and we're parents. But I really, really, really want to make a very, very specific point for us to take care of ourselves, both mentally and physically. We have higher rates of heart disease, higher rates of other comorbidities, higher rates of anxiety, higher rates of depression and all that. And this work creates burnout. And many of us, you know, don't take care of ourselves because we're doing too much of that other work. So I won't get too specific into what those strategies are, but I would point people towards, you know, the SAMHSA 8 Dimensions of Wellness, and just really encourage people to take care of mind, body, and spirit at all times, because if we're not healthy ourselves, we're not going to really be able to help anybody else out. Now, specifically to the topic here, I mean, I think that the question was kind of a little bit about the context. I mean, we have the historical context of racism. We have the current context of racism that people deal with every single day. There's more of a greater recognition, like Lenora said. There's the macro structures that create, you know, the social determinants, you know, inadequacies and inequities in housing, inequities in the criminal justice system, inequities across all employment, wealth creation. All of these things create the context that ultimately lead us to have increased risk for illness, and then decrease ability to then access services. And I think that the system needs to have a greater recognition of that. And, you know, in my work at the Office of Mental Health, we've done a number of different things over the last few years, and we're continuing to do these things. And I'll talk just for a second about what some of those are. One is to be more public and out front that racism is bad for people's mental health. We have research that's going on right now at one of our research centers that's looking specifically at that. And what they have people do is they have people recount specific instances of racism that they experience. And they do a cortisol test, right? And they test the cortisol level that the person has. Some of these instances are 10 years ago. And they see an increased elevated risk in cortisol levels in the person's body as they're recounting, you know, this event. And there's a whole bunch of other research that's out there, but we've historically looked at racism as just a, as Lenore said, it's just a kind of a health issue or as a moral issue or an ethical issue. But I want, even outside the mental health sector, for it to be a lot more clear that it actually kills people from a mental health perspective. And there's a number of different ways. It's not just in the mental health field that this needs to be known. We need to be more open in a lot of the other sectors. The other thing that I would say is that it's really about resource allocation. You know, mental health services are just a commodity like anything else, and they haven't been historically allocated to communities of color in a way that they were able to be accessed in an equal way. And our agency has included equity requirements in all of the RFPs that any organization needs to respond to in order to access funding from the agency. But we've also really expanded the way our thinking is around where we end up putting programs. So for example, that we have new funding that's coming out for the creation of new school-based mental health clinics. And in the allocation of where the clinics are, we've had a very thoughtful, you know, approach to make sure that this funding in these new clinics are going to end up being in communities that you know, need it the most. Because, you know, frankly, a lot of times the organizations and communities that are able to access funding are ones that might be doing better off in the first place. So we really want to drill down and make sure that we're being a lot more thoughtful in that way. The other thing that I would say is that we need to continue to make sure that we're building a workforce that's responsive and a workforce that represents brown people, right? Historically, whether we're talking about social work, whether we're talking about psychology, whether we're talking about licensed mental health counselors or psychiatrists, we don't have enough brown faces and brown people working in the mental health field. And we, this year, we've allocated $4 million that we're giving to SUNY and CUNY for funding of up to $10,000 for diverse or multilingual individuals to then go into the mental health training professions. And the interesting thing, and it'll be above 400 people. 400 people are going to go into the field, black people, diverse individuals, and people that are multilingual that would have not been entering the mental health field previously. And the great thing about the funding is that it's going to be able to be used for a wide range of things, tuition, but transportation, childcare, paid internships, all of the different added things that we might need to make sure that we're able to succeed and then get completion and certification in those roles in the field is going to be able to happen because of this. It's funding that is one-time funding that we're hoping is then going to be furthered after this, but we're really looking forward to the outcomes of that. And lastly, I just wanted to say that the Office of Mental Health wants to continue to be a resource and wants to continue to really stimulate connections with the communities that we have throughout the state. I know that I know many of you fairly well. I want to continue those collaborations. I want to continue to really drill down and find out more about what we can do as an agency to support a system that is way more culturally responsive to the individuals that we serve. And a lot of that really depends on us getting face-to-face information about what the needs in the community are. Because frankly, historically, the way things work is that decisions are made, but it doesn't include the moms, the fathers, the grandmothers, the uncles, the young people that actually have the needs in the first place. And we need to, even as an agency, do a lot better job at making sure we're getting information directly from the communities that we serve and the individuals that we know. So again, that's my first question, but I just want us to really found this on power and hope today.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Matt. Thank you for that information regarding what initiatives are going on and sharing your personal story and journey. So thank you. At this time, we're going to have Dr. Myra Mathis come with her first question. This is very personal for me. Dr. Myra Mathis is very dear to me and many of us. MD, addiction psychiatrist at the University of Rochester Medical Center, instructor of psychiatry and addiction, and has a strong interest in health equity and racial justice through scholarship in the development of a collaborative community partnership. She is a sought-out speaker. I can tell you I'm booking her only, was the chief psychiatric resident at Yale and often share messages about mental health through the lens of social justice. So Dr. Myra Mathis, as a Black female psychiatrist, can you talk about addressing inequities and disparities across the mental health system through the lens of social justice?
Yes, thank you, Sarah, for the question, and thank you for the invitation to be a part of this esteemed panel of community advocates and service providers and clinicians who are really committed to advancing the healthcare of Black people and the mental health care of people of color. So thank you for having me. So let's talk about addressing inequities and disparities in mental health through the lens of social justice. First, just some groundwork. So 1 in 5 individuals in the U.S. have a mental health condition. And for the general population, 50% of those individuals with a mental health condition will access treatment. However, this 50% drops to 30% for Black individuals who need mental health treatment. Essentially, only 30% of Black people who need mental health treatment then receive it. And when we think about the kind of care that Black individuals are receiving, compared to non-Hispanic whites, Black individuals have lower rates of any outpatient mental health services. So when we're talking about outpatient mental health services, that includes being prescribed medications and or receiving outpatient therapy services. But they have higher rates of inpatient psychiatric services. And when we think about engagement in inpatient psychiatric services, this is when individuals are more likely to encounter aspects of the mental health system that can be perceived as more carceral, right? So in inpatient psychiatric services and inpatient psychiatric systems, Black individuals are more likely then to have physical restraints. They are more likely to be placed in seclusion compared to white individuals. They're more likely to be prescribed higher doses of antipsychotics compared to white individuals, more likely to be diagnosed with psychotic illnesses rather than mood disorders compared to white individuals. And so much of this happens in the inpatient setting compared to an outpatient setting where you're building a relationship with someone and getting to know them over time. And in addition to all of this, Black individuals are less likely than to receive guideline consistent treatment, less likely to be included in research, more likely to utilize emergency rooms, crisis services, or even primary care services rather than mental health specialists. And this lack of appropriate treatment or receiving appropriate treatment based on their needs and the likelihood that we're more likely to present in crisis than to have ongoing management of our mental health conditions, this contributes to and is paralleled by the criminalization of mental health conditions in Black communities, leading to an overrepresentation of Black individuals with mental health conditions in our legal and carceral systems. And of course, this is most detrimental for Black and brown children who find that their behavior is not just pathologized, but it is also criminalized, and it contributes to the school-to-prison pipeline. So when considering all of this through the lens of social justice, I feel it is most apropos to invoke and reflect on the words of Dr. Martin Luther King. He said, "Of all forms of inequality, injustice in health is the most shocking and the most inhumane because it often results in physical death." And there is a catchy phrase that often is shared, that there is no health without mental health. But it's more than just a catchy phrase, because individuals with severe and persistent mental illness have a decreased life expectancy by 20 years compared to the general population. So when we think about our mental health and wellness, it is commensurate with our physical health and wellness and the totality of our well-being. And if we are going to approach this from the lens of social justice, then we have to recognize that social justice is a concept that all people should have equal access to wealth, health, well-being, privileges, and opportunities. And so in order to address mental health disparities and inequities through the lens of social justice, we do need to think about all aspects of our well-being and our life. That includes the allocation of resources to our communities. That includes, as Mr. Knutson was speaking about, the distribution of specific mental health resources embedded within the communities that need them most. We need, as a Black communities, to be able to develop those longitudinal outpatient relationships with clinicians that get to know us in a deep way, in a way that is culturally responsive, that understands the dynamics of our families and our cultures and our lives, rather than only seeing us in a moment of crisis. When we present to emergency rooms in crisis, those clinicians then see us at our worst state. And they are building pictures of our lives based on the worst snapshot and our lowest points, rather than appreciating the strengths that are present in our communities, the very complex, nurturing, and beautiful relationships that we develop as Black people and as people of color. These kind of relationships are only built over time. They're more appropriate for an outpatient setting. And that means we need more clinicians of color. Yes, we absolutely need to be investing in the pipeline for clinicians across the spectrum, whether it's psychiatrists, mental health care counselors, social workers, substance use disorder practitioners. We need all of them, and we need investment to make sure that those individuals are placed in our communities so that we can build these relationships, so that we can receive culturally responsive care, get appropriate diagnosis, be less likely to go into inpatient systems where we are then more harm and we are re-traumatized, and then less likely to end up in carceral systems where our behavior is not just pathologized but criminalized.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mathis. A mouthful that we can digest. Because one thing I do know in this current environment in crisis, it's those large healthcare systems that have failed our children and our families that are the first at the table when those funding streams that we're talking about are coming down the pipe. So we shall see what efforts are embedded into the communities. Junior?
Yeah, thank you so much. So now I'm going to introduce a man that I just met recently, actually, very, very dynamic man who's just so passionate about this work. Eddie Blanding is an inspirational speaker, licensed master social worker, life coach who offers solution-focused goals and strategies, who has extensive history working with high school and community-based services. He's also a preacher, photographer, and well-sought crisis intervention and conflict management speaker for Black males. So Eddie, as a Black male clinician working within a school system, you see firsthand the results of the social determinants of health. What is some of the foundational work that must happen if we are going to successfully address the social and emotional health of young Black boys?
Hello, hello, hello all. First of all, thank you, Mr. Dillon, for for that wonderful introduction. Thank you, Sarah, for having me on, and all the wonderful people that's here on this panel. I do appreciate and respect each and every one of you. And man, those that I have to follow. Anyhow, I do want to, I'm not going to, should I say, regurgitate all of the information that was already said about the history, about the statistics and the numbers. I probably just give you from, since I'm going to be answering from a foundational work perspective, just a few things that's on my mind about where we are and where our school systems are. Also, I want to mention that I had some great accolades coming in, but what really drives my passion, what really drives what I do is being at one point homeless myself, being at one point crack addicted and out of my mind and took a bunch of pills and attempted suicide, been in the Rochester Psychiatric Center, dropped out of school in ninth grade and have a master's degree now. And I say all of that to say that that's what really drives me. Also, a lot of the work I've done outside of the school, working on homicide scenes and trying to help calm down families while their babies laying in the street and some other stuff that I've done. So I'll just say that those are the things that drive me the most, more than any education I've ever had or any other accolades that may be on my wall. So I say that to say that some of the smaller things we need to look at in terms of our young men and especially in terms of the school system. First of all, I think about it. I have five daughters and one son. I have five granddaughters and I have four grandsons. And I think about how I treat them different. And so I just want to say that we must be careful, because if one of my grandsons or my son scrapes his knee, you know how it is. Boy, get up. What's wrong with you? Dust yourself off. But I'm carrying my daughters, I'm cuddling them and helping them through their hurt and their pain. And so we must find a time and find a place where we can say to young men, it's okay not to be okay. It's okay to say it hurt, excuse my language, versus saying I'm pissed off, right? I've been hurt. I don't like how I feel, and have a space where they can come. I can tell you in the school system, that I'm, first of all, the only African-American male social worker in the building. Out of all the social workers there, and there's probably maybe five male teachers there, maybe. Also, what our young people seeing in the school systems is most of the people that look like them are either, and nothing's wrong with these roles, either sweeping the floor, doing maintenance, doing housekeeping, doing the lunch lines, and then those that somewhat police, SSO, should I say, are what they see. And so they need more role models. But I do want to say this also. When I look in the system and where we have to start at, so again, first of all, we have to start at home, right? And we have to begin talking to our own boys about their value, their worth, and their dignity. I must say that a lot of the young men that I talk to, nothing against single moms and mothers and African-American ladies. But just a couple of days ago, a young man was talking to me and his mom say to him, I won't go into real detail because I don't want the story, you never know who's watching, but his mom didn't want to be home and she wanted to be gone when he got home because she didn't want to see his face because he makes her sick to her stomach. And a lot of things are said from that perspective is moms who are operating out of fear because the community is killing our kids and systems are failing our kids. And so one of the tactics that we use for our kids is fear and begin to tell them, you make me sick and I'm going to kill you before somebody else kill you, and those kind of things can also cause our young men to have hurt on top of hurt. So I just want to mention that when you talk about the foundation, that it do start at home. Again, you know, I can tell you this, that we are overserved when it comes to discipline, when it comes to labeling. When I'm talking about overserved, I'm talking about Black young men. I walked around Thursday to the ATL, alternative suspension room, in-school suspension room, looked at the numbers for out-of-school suspension, looked at some of the information for long-term suspension, and most of those were African-American males. When I talk to the people that we have, I happen to be in a school where there's plenty of supports because it's a school where a university connected to that school, and so there's extra supports there. But I will say this, that when I go to some of the mental health opportunities there, although African-American males are high in those numbers of discipline and labeling, They are very low when it comes to support, when it comes to social emotional attention. They are the smaller numbers. And so I just want to mention that we have to look at how we can make sure we have strategic interventions when it comes to our young men. We had an epidemic before the pandemic of young Black men being murdered and killed, incarcerated. All the numbers, all the statistics you heard, I have not seen a strategic intervention plan anywhere to say, listen, it was 82 homicides in the city of Rochester. There was over 300 people shot, and nobody's talking about, they're talking about what happened, but not why. And so one of the things we got to do is get away from talking about what and talk about why. And that's what we have to look at, why we doing what we're doing, or why it's happening to us, and how can we get a voice to deal with the why and not the what. Because when you deal with the what, as mentioned already here, then there's incarceration and a strategic plan on stopping violence or gun violence or drug wars. All this is on the what's, but nobody's dealing with the why, right? And so if we're going to get to the real root cause, and we already know that racism is one of the root causes. We know that, right? But we also have to look at all the other different ways. And when we give our support and help to these young men, that is also about the why. One more thing, I'm gonna share a quick story. I'm sure it'll take only 30 seconds. And it's about narrative, it's about mindsets, it's about thinking. And I even hate to admit this, but I'm gonna say it anyhow. I one day was, and I call this, I'm the white woman. Okay, I'll call that. I'm not trying to offend anybody, but I just want to tell the true story. So one day I was in Wegmans, and it was a Caucasian lady who was clutching her purse and acting weird around me, made me feel uncomfortable. So I went through this system of lagging back. When I come around close to Caucasian people, I would fall back just because I hated that feeling of that I might hurt you, even though I know I could have more money in my pocket, more degrees, but I still felt like I had to change my behavior just to make them feel comfortable. And that kind of mindset is horrible when you're seen as an animal no matter what. College degree, master's degree, helping people in the community and still looked at as a threat will make you have a set of behaviors that will cause you to do things that cause you to be in places that you are jacked up mentally. And some people won't react like I react. I fell back. And other people, man, I wouldn't have fell back. I'll just keep on going. They the one uncomfortable. But I just want to tell you the psychology behind that. And so then one day I'm going to my local church. I put on a nice suit. I collect watches and I put on a nice watch. And I decided the church is close enough for me to walk to it. So I guess I walked to this church. I'll tell you, it was on Arnett and Wellington. So I lived on Wellington at the time. I owned property in Wellington. And I was walking down Wellington in my little nice suit and my little nice watch, and I ran into a group of young men on the corner of Arnett and Wellington. And when I saw them, soon as I saw them, the first thing I did is I became the white woman that made me feel like I felt, right? Because the narrative is so crazy and so strong that we have to somehow deal with it. So the first thing I do is ease my nice watch off and put it in my pocket. The second thing I do is my whole walk changed. The way I walk, the way I approach them, and the way I, you know, what's up, where, what up, you know, I code switch real quick because the psychology is I felt scared of my own people because that's the kind of stuff that we've been taught, and that's the kind of stuff that we even go through ourselves. And so we have to now, when we talk about dealing with this foundational stuff, we got to deal with the work on how we feel about each other also. So I just wanted to put that out there that I became the white woman. To sum this up, you heard it before, it's not what's wrong with me, but what happened to me. Yeah. One more thing I'm going to say from that kind of perspective too. History definitely tell us what happened to us, right? So, but I realize when I'm working with some of the people that I work with, it's not what happened to us, it's what's happening to us. Still very much happened just in different ways. And so I want to make sure we definitely be aware of the history and make sure we're very clear on what's still in our face right now today. Thank you.
Great, great, great. Thank you so much, Eddie, for that insightful, Mr. Blanding, for that insightful perspective on foundational work. Our next speaker, we're going to bring up right away because we want to move. We want to get through a second round. Diane Johnson is a service coordinator director in Allegheny County's Pittsburgh area, largest program serving more than 2,000 individuals each year. With more than 20 years of experience, leadership experience across the mental health and the juvenile justice system. And Diane, you know I can say this as my sister, growing up, we have heard many things like that came from daddy's side of the family, that came from mommy's side of the family, just in general in the Black community, saying what it is and what it isn't. Diane, can you talk about family dynamics and engagement and the various levels of circumstances, such as bias, shame, and guilt, and even denial when it comes with having a loved one who is experiencing challenges and symptoms related to mental health conditions?
Well, thank you, Sarah, and I enjoy what I'm hearing so far from so many of you talented individuals. I don't want to repeat a lot of the things that have already been said, but as Sarah had stated, when I was a kid, we didn't know much about mental illness. We were always told that somebody was not quite right in the head, or someone was just real simple, or somebody was on the slow bus. So we just kind of we didn't victimize them, but we're cautious around them. And what I'm saying to you today is not a lot has changed. We still are real guarded regarding the people that are suffering from mental illness. Even in my home, my stepdaughter, she's severely mentally ill. And after dealing with mental illness all day at work, when I come home, sometimes I don't want to deal with it. But one thing about it, whether you deal with it or not, it's going to be in your face. And treatment is not as easy to navigate through, because it's all depending on how the individual responds to the treatment. And sometimes it's not easy to diagnose individuals and get a good treatment plan in place. And a lot of us or family members become victims of the system, and we always find ways to try to not feel bad so you can support the person. But a lot of times you just don't want to support the person anymore. You want to isolate the person from your life because it brings a lot of heartache. But we still have to remember that these individuals are people that need our help, and we need to support them. And we might need to be in support groups. We may need to look at ways we can get help, because it's not going to be something that's going to change overnight. It's going to be a chronic issue that you're going to be dealing with as long as you are a member of that family. Also, I think that at work, when I come home from work, I hear a lot of people's stories, and I think, what can I do to make a difference in the lives of the people we serve? And one of the things I learned to do was listen to their story. Like the young man said, it's not what's wrong with them, what happened to them. Nobody wants to be mentally ill. A lot of times people, genetics, put you in a position where you have an illness that you're dealing with. A lot of times people, have dealt with drug and alcohol, and as a result, find themselves dealing with mental illness. And a lot of them have been victimized sexually, physically, and emotionally, and they find themselves in a position that they're dealing with mental illness. No matter how it came upon you, it is something that is not easy to address. And so when I go to work every day, or when I go home every day, I think of ways that, I can assist individuals. And a lot of times it's being patient, being resourceful, and finding resources for individuals that can help the whole entire family, not just the person that's getting treatment. Because whether you're a kid, a parent, or the parent of an adult that's struggling, there's a lot of resources out there that people just don't know about. But one of the things I found in looking for resources for individuals and their family is the person is the best source of resources for themselves. They know what they need. They know what's out there. A lot of times they just need help navigating through the systems that are out there. And that's what we do. That's pretty much it, because so much has been already said.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Junior?
Thank you. Thank you. Wow. So for sure, right now, I definitely have the pleasure of introducing somebody that, for me, made me feel like I was home as a British Caribbean person that traveled to the United States 11 years ago. Mama Mel, Aunt Mel, Melanie Funches, the CEO and principal at Ubuntu Village Works LLC, rebuilding and healing for the village, for the people, by the people. A healer, and she's well sought out and continues to be a force in this community and around the country, determined to hold providers and systems accountable at all levels without sugarcoating her message, and that is for real. So welcome, welcome, Melanie. So Melanie, you've been out here a long time advocating across the mental health system. Can you talk about addressing racism, bias, and provider accountability from a systems level perspective?
Yes. Good morning, everybody. I'd like to first say thank you, and I am honored for this opportunity. And I wouldn't be Melanie if I didn't do Junior. So I just had to do it. Sorry, y'all.
Yes, Wagwan, Wagwan.
What I want to talk about first is a couple of things. I want to also do some level setting and talk about the fact that, first, anti-Blackness and white supremacy are a global phenomenon. And it is perpetual. It could be perpetuated by everybody because we all drank the same Kool-Aid. We were all fed, irrespective of race, socioeconomic status, we were all fed the same messages. And also, but at the same time, conversely, risk factors are not predictive factors because of protective factors. In holding systems accountable and addressing racism and bias, we first have to understand that racism and bias is a thing and that it exists in all of our systems. It just does. And in doing that, there are two different types of solutions. There are technical solutions, solutions that are about policies and procedures and practice change. But then there are adaptive solutions, solutions about the changing of thoughts, attitudes, and behaviors. What we need to do is we need to address these in both ways. The way we do this on the technical side is the increased numbers of Black clinicians across the continuum of care. That is your master's level clinicians, your psych NPs, your psych PAs, your psychiatrists, your psychologists, the whole continuum of care. That is also training for everyone who is currently in the system, because our educational systems do not adequately prepare mental health people to deal in culturally responsive ways. It comes with an understanding on the systems level that we need to fund Black-led organizations that come from an Afrocentric perspective. Being Black is not enough. Because we were all fed this same message, we can perpetuate Eurocentric ways that are harmful to our own people. So we need to have funding, we need to have training, we need to have increased workforce. We also need, within the training, and we also need to increase the education. We need our system to create educational opportunities for students of color to learn about these fields and be able to go into them without having the disproportionate levels of debt and costs that are prohibitive to many people. On the adaptive side, we need to have people come in and do their own work. And we have got to be able to hold providers accountable to outcomes. And these outcomes, we need to have a new framework for how we measure outcomes. Because our systems are made from Eurocentric paradigms, our outcomes measures are also made from those paradigms. But because people of the African diaspora, Black folks, have a different axiology than Eurocentric folks, the way we organically experience the world is different. So what we see is as important, and the way we get it and the way it fits for us is also different. So what I want us to do on the adaptive side is to really have people do their own work, look at their own biases, do some anti-biasing work, and also figure out how we can look differently, not just at as a provider continuum of the people we serve, but let us look inward. Because what happens is, even if we get more people in the system, they get burnt out from the racism and bias they experience in the systems in which they work. So we have got to do inward facing and outward facing work to make sure that we create systems that are held accountable. And I mean, when I mean being held accountable, that your money is on the line. That if you do not offer good, comprehensive, culturally responsive services, and that you do not measure those with comprehensive, culturally responsive outcomes measures, that you will lose your money. Period. Once we are able to do this, we will make this shift. Now, this will not happen overnight, but there's people like me, people like Lenora, all of us out here, people like Junya out here doing this work, and we can do this. But these are things we need to do on the systems level. We need our New York State regions to mandate culturally responsive coursework as to be licensed in New York State. I'm being really specific. We need our regents to step up, because once they step up and put it in place, the schools will have to follow. We need our state government, we need our health systems, and we need all of our county government to create financial incentives and educational opportunities for people of color to go into this work. And we need to create coaching and support mechanisms all the way through the continuum of care to keep people in this work and to reduce burnout. That's just a quick overview of the things that we need, and I hope that answered your question.
Fantastic. Thank you, Melanie. Sarah?
Thank you so much, and we can go on and on. We're going to have her come again and again and again, all of our experts. Okay, so we are going to take a shift after this next expert panelist comes up, because there's a lot of questions in the chat, and we want to respect that in the questions and answers. So our next expert speaker is Chandra Redfern from Buffalo, New York, is the Chief Executive Officer at Buffalo Federation Neighborhood Centers, with years of experience in housing, mental health, case management, adolescent pregnancy prevention. She's also a faith leader and a member of New York State Suicide Prevention Task Force. We don't often talk about suicide in our homes, churches, and communities until it hits home. And of course, recently, we've seen celebrities impacted. Through your work with the Suicide Task Force, you see in the numbers. You see the numbers, you hear the tragedies. What can be done to address the disparities, perceptions, stigma from a system, personal level, related to prevention and education?
Well, good morning, everyone, and thank you, Sarah, for this opportunity. And it's interesting, when you go last, everybody's kind of put everything out there, right? But I think the theme is very evident. So I just wanted to just give a few little tidbits. So there are over 800,000 suicides. People die per suicide every year, right? Every 40 seconds, someone dies from suicide. And the thing that we as a community of color need to also understand is that the rates are increasing in our Black youth. So from 2007 to 2017, there was an 89% increase in suicides amongst Black youth, right? So historically, we've been a small percentage of the number, but when you start looking at the increases, and I'm sure that they're going to be even greater considering everything that we've gone through, we have a problem. And we've had a problem, right? And so one of the things that we do on the Erie County Coalition, as well as the State Advisory Board, is we look at, okay, what's going on in terms of suicide prevention and education in the BIPOC community. And I will just say that, you know, and all of our other panelists have touched on it and expounded on it, we can't talk about prevention without looking at this from a social justice framework, right? So at the end of the day, when you have people that are disproportionately affected by inequities and discrimination and have historical and current day trauma, like we have to look at developing strategies that address these issues, right? Through education, engagement, and access, and advocacy. I've heard it said several times on this panel this morning, there has to be dollars, right? We need funds for research. When we look at how things are researched, right, people of color are typically not in the research pools. So when you're trying to apply preventative strategies to a group of people that you've never even researched or gotten to know what's going on with them, that's a big, big issue. Because the reality is, and we have to acknowledge it, that Black people, brown people are different, right? We've had different experiences. So we can't apply a one-size-fits-all type of solution. You know, the other thing that when we look at addressing these issues is that, you know, we have to look at our representation when it comes to the issue of suicide. So we know that typically we don't talk about it, right? It doesn't even exist. I mean, I'll just be honest. I'm a faith leader and I'm Black, right? It doesn't exist. You do not talk about those things, okay? So we have to have better representation. There has to be representation when we're looking at what is put out there in terms of preventative media, right? So we do hear every once in a while, we hear about a Black or brown person that has committed suicide. I know there's been a few things recently in the news, but really, when you look at the comparisons, it's few and far between, but that does not mean that it's not happening. And so when you put these things out, you start to normalize for people being able to speak about this, being able to bring up these things. And it's not that we're trying to highlight, you know, suicide, but we're trying to highlight that it does happen in our community. So we need to have better representation. And, you know, we need to spend some time as well looking at the engagement and access. Again, all the previous panelists have talked about that. So where do I go if I'm feeling a certain kind of way? I feel like I don't want to live anymore. I feel like there's no hope. I'm in crisis. I'm not thinking straight. Who do I talk to? You know, and that's the access to providers. And that in itself is very systemic. And I've, again, heard it said this morning, but we're looking at insurance and what insurance covers, right? A lot of times as Black and brown people, we don't have that coverage. We don't know we have that coverage, and we don't know who we can turn to talk to, but it even starts before then. And one of the things that we do on the coalition is we've actually developed a curriculum. So there's a Talk Saves Lives, which is a suicide prevention curriculum, but we have developed that for the BIPOC community, for Black people. So we talk about Black people's issues. We talk about things that, you know, Reverend Blanding had spoken about, you know, things like, oh, well, you know, we're tough. We don't talk about that. You know, you don't cry about that. We talk about those things. And the fact that, you know, we as people have to be mindful that sometimes you just can't say those things. So I think not only on a community perspective, a provider perspective, but on a personal level, we have to be able to address those things. We have to allow people opportunity. When we see our Black and brown boys crying, our Black and brown men saying, I'm hurt, you know, that has me feeling some kind of way. I don't know what I'm going to do. We don't need to ostracize them. We don't need to say man up or things like that to them. We need to work with them to address those types of issues, right? Because we know that our Black and brown boys, they are higher than the girls, right? Because culturally, what we've spoken about. So those are just some of the things I'm trying to be mindful. Sarah was very specific with us, so I want to be mindful of that. And again, all of our panelists were excellent, and they've really touched on the issue. And I'll end with this by saying, when we talk about suicide prevention, right, we need to really look at it as a mental health issue. So it's not standalone. So if we're going to look at preventative measures for that, we have to look at how do we address mental health issues in the Black community.
Thank you so much. You know, I mean, I just can't thank you for that information. We need to talk about it. We need to educate ourselves about it. And you hit on something important. When we talk about research and strategy, I often wonder who's a part of that research and that data. Not us. And so I think that's so important when we talk about research and some of these evidence-based practice and models, where they come from. We're going to take a quick shift. We have heard from our panelists, and they are okay answering some of the questions that have been filtered through the question and answer tool. We asked you to please use the question and answer tool, and we're going to ask the panelists, if you're okay, I've heard from most of you, to respond to some of the questions in there. And if you can please, I need you to sum it up, okay? Sum it up. I'm going to start with Mrs. Funches. I know there was a question that you wanted to respond to specifically, so it's all yours in a minute, please.
Okay. There was a question about being able to be connected to Black therapists and Black like psychiatrists, people, prescribers, and being able to get this because you had insurance and financial challenges. I am going to put my contact information in the chat. Get the contact information, send me an email, because through my program, Healers Village, we have found a way that we do connect Black people to Black clinicians who are good clinicians who work in culturally responsive ways, and we have abilities to overcome financial barriers, period.
Great. Thank you so much. Dr. Myra, you wanted to reply to a question in the chat. Dr. Mathis?
Yes, so briefly, just to Phyllis's question, I think the most important thing that helps people know that mental health is something that can be helped is when they see other examples of it. So you heard examples of people on this call who have experienced mental health challenges and other types of substance use challenges and have recovered. And I think that is an important message. And we all go through things. We all have challenges in life. And it doesn't mean that you are the quote C word. Whenever, if you have high blood pressure, you go see your doctor. If you have depression or anxiety, you can talk to someone and you can get help.
Thank you. I believe there was a question in the chat as well directed at Matthew Knutson regarding funding through scholarships and specific grants.
Yeah, just two pieces real quick. I put a whole bunch of information in the chat just so that people can access it that way, so I can keep this part short. So if that person shoots me an email, I can let them know how to access that funding. But out of everything that I wrote, the only thing I didn't address yet was that Melanie talked a little bit about, and a few people did, a big important thing that we need to continue to work on. And some of that's through training, but a lot of it's through self-reflection. We still have a lot of clinician bias. And clinician bias is one of the hugest things that we have. Research just came out last week that talked about in the electronic medical record of Black patients, words such as violent, aggressive, non-compliant was used at rates of 3 times higher than people's white counterparts. And sometimes that was also when the clinicians were Black themselves. So that's part of the reason we need to add training in addition to some of the policy things that I also added there. But that's a very important point. But all the information is in the chat.
Thank you. Sarah, you was muted.
Yes. Is there another panelist that would like to address some of the questions in the chat?
I can address one of the questions, Sarah.
Go ahead.
One of the questions, once somebody has been diagnosed, what kind of help can they get after that? There are services like psychiatric rehab, rehabilitation, social rehabilitation, clubhouses, individual therapy. There is also certified peer programs, and there's supportive housing programs. So there's a lot of services once you have been diagnosed that assist individuals with managing their mental illness.
Thank you for that. And whomever answered the question, I would encourage you to talk to the providers and find out if they have culturally responsive models, because there's resources out there, but we also want to make sure that the resources are culturally responsive.
I just quickly want to address Megan Simpson's series of questions about a sort of skills-based psychoeducation peer support group. This really does sound like a consultation question. And so I would encourage you to reach out to one of the panelists to think about how this can be talked through in a consultation session, to be very thoughtful about how you develop that group.
Sorry, I would be happy. I'd be happy to respond to some of that as well. Actually, I'd started a Black men's group during the pandemic as well. It was very much like a process group, and so and I teach at the U of R as well. So I'd be happy to be one of those people you'd consult with.
Great, great, great.
And I just want to add briefly that we have to make sure that we create a precision of fit between any intervention that we do and the need that exists, because we do not want to perpetuate harm, even unknowingly and unmeaningly. It is not about intent, it's about impact. So I would say to make sure that anything that is done, that if you're using standard models, understand that Black folk are just not standard people.
Great, great. Well, we are at the end of our 90 minutes, and I can't thank you enough. Lit is give our panelists a hand. I'm going to ask our tech team to please put the session evaluation in the chat where everyone can get it. We asked you to give us some feedback. We have some deliverables, some learning objectives, and we ask that you complete the anonymous survey. Please complete the survey, because we want to look forward to next week and we want to be able to improve and to make sure that we are hitting learning objectives. I can't thank all the panelists for the content and the information you shared. You know, I say it over and over, for us, by us. We have some of the solutions to the issues that are going on. And when it comes to mental health, we have some of the ideas, some of the strategies, and we know what's going on in our communities. So I can't thank you enough for being with us, all of our sponsors, all of our partners that have made this possible, and you parents, caregivers that are in the room that have been struggling, there is help for you, and we are here to help you in whatever way possible. And again, I can't thank you enough. Please complete the evaluation. Tell someone about it. We have three more series to go over the next three Saturdays. We have some amazing speakers from all over the state, all over the country, primarily New York State, that will be featured. And again, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you so much, and we are hopeful that some information will be able to help you in your work, in your home, in your community, in your organization. So have a wonderful, wonderful day. Visit us on our website if you have any information about the upcoming series, and share it with someone in your community. Have a wonderful, wonderful day. Jay, you can play this slide. Show.